Hello everyone. In this lecture, we will be discussing more details about Wasserstein GAN and what analysis we can infer from it. The main target of this lecture will be to gain more insights into Wasserstein GANs. So as discussed in our earlier lecture, as you might recall, that the JS divergence was the main problem in the learning process of generator. So if we can replace the JS divergence by the Wasserstein distance, then it will be able to solve our purpose. So considering that into our motivation, what we are doing now is we are actually minimizing the Wasserstein distance between the probability distribution, which is the actual distribution that we want to approximate, and the p theta is the generated distribution. Here theta are basically the parameters of the generator network, which will try to tune this p theta to generate probability distributions as close as possible to px. So our main target in Wasserstein GAN is to minimize this Wasserstein distance. So as we have discussed earlier also, this Wasserstein distance is basically given in this form. This we have discussed in greater detail in our last lecture, but this distance is basically intractable. So in order to make it tractable, what happens is the authors have used this duality principle to approach the approximation of this Wasserstein distance using this formulation, which is given over here. So as you can see, it's basically a supremum. This is supremum. Supremum means maximum, actually. Maximum of all the functions with Lipschitz constant less than equal to 1. This is basically the Lipschitz constant. We will discuss about Lipschitz constant in coming slides, but for now you assume that it's basically telling you that the slope of the curve should not exceed 1 in the neighborhood of the point of interest. Let us say if you have a curve which is given like this, and if this is the point of interest, then you look in the small neighborhood of that point and you take these two points over here. And these two points are basically what? They are f of x1 and f of x2, corresponding to the points x1 and x2. So these are the neighborhood points for the actual point of interest, which is x0. So if you calculate the slope of this line here, which is f of x1 minus f of x2 divided by x1 minus x2, it is the slope of the line and it should not exceed, let us say, k, then it will be called as k Lipschitz continuity. And if its value is 1, then it is called as 1 Lipschitz continuity. So that's what is saying over here. And what it is saying is, it is taking the maximum of all the functions that are parameterized by d having the Lipschitz continuity, having the Lipschitz constant less than 1. So we are approximating this Wasserstein distance using this approximation which is given over here. So the next approximation that we are doing over here is, we are actually replacing this supremum family which is given here with a parameterized family of functions dw. So we will replace this particular function with again parameterized family of dw, which is this one. So we are replacing supremum with this highlighted section. So once we replace supremum with this highlight section, then it is obtained as this form, which is given over here. It is basically maximum of w taken from this w family with a function parameterized by dw, which is given over here. And this dw should have a Lipschitz constant smaller than k. So once you substitute this value, this is basically what? This is basically the Wasserstein's approximation using this function. And what we are doing as a whole, we are minimizing this Wasserstein distance as we have discussed over here. So once you put that values, you can obtain this function. And this is basically the same as this one, but what I have done is I have taken the expectation inside. So once we have taken the expectation inside, we are having dw of x, where x is sampled from the real data. And here it is dw g theta of z, where g theta of z is basically the generated samples, which are then passed through the discriminator network. It is same as that of the case of GAN. But here dw are actually it is a parameterized family of the functions having Lipschitz constant less than or equal to k. So in order to enforce this inequality, that is the Lipschitz constant should be less than or equal to k, what we do is we perform the concept of clipping of the weights means clipping the parameters of the dw, which are actually weights and biases of the neural network. So we clip the parameters of these weights having in some range of minus C to C. If we clip these parameters in between minus C to C, we are actually enforcing this condition which is given over here. This is basically a same type of neighborhood that we have discussed over here, where we have taken the neighborhoods as x1 and x2. In the same way, we are taking the neighborhoods here as minus C and C. So we are considering that this dw will be Lipschitz continuous in between minus C and C. So the weights and biases will lie in this range, which in turn satisfies this condition which is given over here. So basically this Wasserstein distance which is given over here is easily approximated using this particular argument. And what we are doing, we are minimizing the whole distance in order to minimizing the Wasserstein distance between the two functions, which are this and this. So this is basically the loss function corresponding to WGAN, which we will optimize. If we keep the mathematics aside, if we see this objective function, what you observe? You observe that these are the two functions, this one and this one, and we are trying to minimize these two functions. That means we are bringing this function and this function close towards each other. So if you see in terms of the diagram, then what will happen is you have this generator network represented by G theta, and this is basically the noise distribution Z, as was in the case of GAN also. This sample from this noise distribution is basically fed into G theta, which in turn produces G theta of Z. And in the same way, you have a sample from the real data set also, that is X. And then what you are doing is you are then feeding these two into a DW network, which is basically now a critic. And it is not a discriminator which will try to discriminate as in it was in the case of GAN, where it was producing either a value of 0 or 1 when it was fake or real. But in this case, it's acting as a critic and not as a discriminator. And by meaning of critic means it will be actually telling you how close these two distributions are when they are fed into this box. So basically, if you feed this x into this box dw, it will produce dw of x, and if g theta z of it comes from here, it will produce g theta of z dw times of that. So basically this critic will actually evaluate the difference in the distance between these two probability distribution functions and will result in a value which is either close to zero, which means that the two distributions are close to each other, or will be a very high value, which means these two distributions are very far apart from each other. On basis of that, what will happen is the gradients will be evaluated with respect to delta w for critic, and that will tune the parameters of this dw, or gradients will be evaluated with respect to theta, and it will tune the parameters of this generator network, so that in the next cycle it will try to bring dw of x and g theta of z as close as possible in terms of Wasserstein distance. So in summary, in the original GAN, the discriminator was tackling the binary classification problem. So the last layer was using sigmoid function to normalize the results, but now the WGAN is basically approximating the Wasserstein distance, as I told you over here. That is, once it feeds x into this dw, and once it feeds g theta z into dw, it will produce these variables, which are this, and then it is actually calculating the Wasserstein distance between the two PDFs. So it's basically a regression problem, because you are trying to fit one probability distribution over to the another, which is a standard one. So the sigmoid layer will not be there in the Wasserstein distance in its last layer. So that is also an important point. So now we will discuss the difference between the approaches that are taken by WGAN and GAN. So let's list out the differences that separates WGAN with GAN. The very first difference, which is very important, is we are removing the sigmoid activation function in the last layer of the discriminator network. And the reason for that is, as you know, that the discriminator network here, it's not working as a classification problem, but it is working as a regression problem. Why? Because we are trying to bring the generated distribution as close as possible to that of the real distribution. So it's basically a regression problem. So that's why there will be no sigmoid layer at the output of the discriminator layer. So that is the very first difference. The second difference is that there is no log term in the loss function of the WGAN network. As you can see over here, there is no log term here, but in case of GANs, we have the log term. So that's the second difference. The third difference is basically the clipping of the parameters W of the network to lie between the range minus C and C. And the reason for doing that is to satisfy this constraint in order to have K Lipschitz continuity. So that is the third difference. The fourth difference is that the optimization method suggested by the author is taken as RMS prop, and we will not be using Adam here. So that is basically suggested by the authors of this paper. So that is the fourth difference that is to be noted. The fifth difference is that unlike the original GAN, where the updates of the generator gets worse as the discriminator gets better, as we have discussed this in greater detail in our earlier lectures on generative adversarial networks. So the WGAN actually relies on a perfect discriminator. For this reason, the gradients of the discriminator are updated n times. That is, we will train the discriminator n times for every one training of the generator. And typically this n is basically taken as 5. So this provides stability in the training, and it comes at the cost of longer training time as compared to GANs. So in the last, I just wanted to recap one important thing, that the new loss function that we have derived through the Wasserstein distance is not having the log function. That is one of the most important thing. And the discriminator model does not play any direct critic. It's basically acting as a helper for estimating the Wasserstein's matrix between the real and the generated data, as we observed here and explained also. So it's basically acting as an implementation of Wasserstein metric. So it will be working as a regressor as compared to classifier in case of GANs. So this completes the topic of WGAN. In the next lecture, we will implement WGAN in Google Colab, and we will see whether we are able to get better results as compared to GAN or not. Till then, thanks for watching my lecture. See you next time.